From Microsoft, this is the Security Bulletin webcast for September 2013. Now, here's Dustin Childs.
We have a total of 13 bulletins and an advisory revision to cover today, and we'll go through those in detail. But we're also here to take your questions regarding the bulletins. As always, we have a room full of people who are downstairs waiting to answer your questions. I know we've got a few questions queued up already, and that's fantastic. If you already have questions, you can go ahead and start submitting them now by using the Ask button. We're also taking questions through Twitter if you prefer, and you can get your question in under 140 characters. If you want to do that, please just use the hashtag MSFTSecWebcast. I've got the Twitterers up, and if we have the opportunity, we'll be live tweeting through this as well. So let's start by going through our Severity and Exploitability Index slide. As I mentioned, we have 13 bulletins this month, encompassing a total of 47 unique CVEs. There are 4 critical rated bulletins and 9 important rated bulletins. We have a total of 8 bulletins that receive an aggregate XI rating of 1, 2 with an XI of 2. The Excel bulletin, quite interestingly, has an XI of 3, and as always, the denial of service and information disclosure issues default to an XI of 1. So, Jonathan, the first thing I noticed when I looked at this is, wow, Excel is remote code execution, but it has an XI of 3. What makes it? What makes those two CVEs more difficult to exploit?
Yeah, that's one where we got a bunch of vulnerabilities through fuzzing this month from external security researchers. The word bulletin, you'll also see there are a number of fuzzing bugs there. We're addressing these with a security update, but really they're read access violations, so they're less likely to be exploited than we typically see in the write access violations. But we still wanted to get them fixed. They're just less likely to be exploited for code execution in the next 30 days.
Great. Moving on to our deployment slide, we are listing MS-13-067, 068, and 069 as our top bulletin deployment priorities for this month. Following that, we have 5 bulletins listed as a priority 2, with the remaining 5 coming in as a priority of 3. So, Jonathan, I'm looking at this, and there are some things that are pretty obvious to me, i.e., it's typically deployment priority of 1.
Yep.
SharePoint, that's critical. That seems pretty obvious to me. But I look at the Outlook bulletin, which has an XI of 2 and is critical,
mm-hmm.
and the OLE bulletin, which has an XI of 1 and is critical, mm-hmm. yet it's a deployment priority of 2.
Right, yeah.
What is it about Outlook that puts that up a little bit higher than the OLE issue?
Yeah, it's really the attack vector in this case. This one, when we see an Outlook bulletin with a severity of critical, that's an indication that the attack vector is potentially through the Outlook preview pane. And that is the case in this particular bulletin. Just previewing an email, the attacker could run code in that user context. Whereas the OLE, OLE 32 bulletin, we'll talk about a little bit later, that's, excuse me, that's a double click on a file, not a preview, so that's why the attack vector is a little bit more severe in the Outlook.
Right, and I would imagine that as an attacker, Outlook is going to be more of an attractive target.
Yeah,
that's
true.
Just about everyone uses Outlook if you're running Windows, and since it is that preview pane, even though we think it's a little bit more difficult to exploit, we'll get into that as well,
mm-hmm.
it's certainly going to be very attractive for attackers to go after that. And the exploit index, kind of as a reminder, really covers the first 30 days post-release. And we know with an issue as attractive like this, it wouldn't surprise me if a few months down the line somebody came up with something really interesting and unique.
Yeah, so this is a juicy target for sure.
Absolutely.
Talk a little bit more about some mitigating factors on this one a little bit later.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great. So with that, let's go ahead and look at each of these bulletins in detail, starting with the update for SharePoint. MS-13-067 addresses multiple issues in SharePoint, the most severe of which could allow remote code execution. As I mentioned, this is a deployment priority of 1 and has an exploit index of 1. We have a total of 10 CVEs here, only one of which was public, 9 privately reported, and we're not aware of any active attacks. So we only have 1 critical CVE here, and let's start by talking with that one,
mm-hmm.
and that's CVE 2013-1330. So, Jonathan, SharePoint isn't as familiar to me, so let's work through what makes a critical SharePoint issue. What's the attack scenario here? And I know from reading the bulletin, we get the W3WP service account. Let's go through what that is as well.
Yeah, typically when we address SharePoint vulnerabilities, they're cross-site scripting vulnerabilities, and those are regularly rated important. And in fact, we have a number of those in this bulletin being addressed, but there is that one critical. This is a case... it's a little bit complicated to explain, but the server and the client maintain state between each other. Sometimes websites do this with a cookie. In the SharePoint case, it's a complex state they need to maintain. So the server encodes all this state, like all this stuff is going on in the conversation, in a variable called view state. Now, it would be bad news if the client were able to manipulate that view state and mess with it. So what normally happens, what normally protects that view state from being manipulated, is this cryptographic function called a MAC. And in almost all the cases in SharePoint, the view state, almost all the pages, the view state is protected with that MAC. But there are a couple cases, a couple pages, where the MAC was not enabled on that view state. So that's the background. Now, to get to the attack scenario, the attacker would have to log into your SharePoint. Now, if you don't require authentication, that would be easier for them. But if you do require authentication on your SharePoint server, they have to have valid login. Start a conversation with the SharePoint server and get a page that does not require the MAC on the view state. So that comes down to the client. The client manipulates it and encodes a different kind of object than the server is expecting in that view state and sends it back to the server, and the server deserializes it, resulting in a potential code execution on the server. So this is a client browsing to a SharePoint and attacking the server.
Okay, and that gets you the W3WP service account. So what is that?
Right.
That's not kernel mode. So what exactly does that allow an attacker to do?
Right. Yeah. That's a limited rights service that the SharePoint server runs as. It's not system on the box like you were saying. Right. It's the service account that this SharePoint service runs as.
Okay, great. And as we move on to the next slide here, you'll see some additional information about the update itself. We do have one public CVE here, and that's CVE 2013-3180. Jonathan, are we aware of any customer impact or any active attacks around this particular issue?
No, this one actually was posted a number of months ago as a cross-site scripting vulnerability in a third-party website. That's how it came up, and that's what everyone thought. But really, it's an issue that we needed to fix ourselves. So it's been out there for a little while. We haven't seen use of that vulnerability, but this security update addresses it.
Okay, and if you've read the bulletin, if you look under the bulletin FAQs, you'll notice that this bulletin shares some CVEs with the Excel update, which is MS-13-073, and the Word update, which is MS-13-072. So, Jonathan, why is that? Why do we have the shared CVEs amongst three bulletins here?
You know, one of the benefits of being Microsoft is this rich integration between SharePoint and Office apps, and we talk about this one Microsoft. We want to do this more. We have this deep integration between products, and that's awesome for users. But once in a while, when there's vulnerabilities in one product, because of that deep integration, you got to address it in multiple products. So these are Word and Excel services in SharePoint that we have to address in SharePoint as well.
Okay, great. So let's move on to our next bulletin, which is MS-13-068. This is a vulnerability in Microsoft Outlook, which could allow remote code execution. As we mentioned, this is a deployment priority of one, it has an exploit index of 2, and addresses one privately reported CVE. And Jonathan, I know there's been a lot of talk about this already. Outlook always makes people nervous when you get that, especially when we throw in the preview pane. So let's talk about the attack scenario and really some of the difficulties we think that there may be in building a reliable exploit for this issue.
I get nervous when we talk about the Outlook preview pane. But yeah, this is a case where an attacker can send an email and it has these SMIME certificates. So SMIME is an encryption technology used in Outlook, and it allows nesting of certificates. So if you have a certain configuration of nesting in your SMIME certificates, you kind of attach that or associate that with your email. The attacker sends it in, and as Outlook is parsing that message, as it's trying to preview the message, because it has to look at the SMIME configuration in order to show the contents of the message, can potentially trigger a memory corruption vulnerability. The good news, and the reason we wrote that blog, this is a double free condition that's going to be really difficult to exploit. We in the SRD blog, we outlined some of the conditions that are normally necessary to exploit double free vulnerabilities. This one does not have those conditions, so we don't know of any exploit technology or exploit techniques in order to get to remote code execution on this one. But boy, this is a juicy target. That's why we have it deployment priority one. This is the kind of vulnerability that attackers are going to go off and invent new exploit techniques. So the deployment priority cover, or the exploitability index rating, really covers that first 30 days. We'd recommend getting this deployed in the first 30 days. We don't see the attackers are going to generate an exploit for this unless we're, it'd be hard. So, but in the future, who knows?
Yeah, and if you want to read that SRD blog, I actually just live tweeted it out. With the hashtag of MSFTSecWebcast, so you can check that out from our handle, which is, MSFTSecResponse.
Right.
So you can get a link to that. I know Jinwook did some great, am I saying his name right?
Jinwook. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Did a great job of putting that together, and it even shows some code that you can take a look in there and see some of the difficulties. So that's great, and again, that link is available through Twitter right now if you want to go straight there and take a look at that. Okay, moving on to our next update, MS-13-069 is our cumulative update for Internet Explorer. The most severe issue we're addressing this month could allow remote code execution. Again, this is a deployment priority of 1 and has an XI of 1 for all but 2 of the CVEs addressed here. We're addressing 10 CVEs, all of which were privately reported. Now, before we go on, we should also point out that we are now listing Internet Explorer 11 as the latest version for the purposes of exploit index. As you may have seen, on Monday, the Windows 8.1 RTM bits, which include IE11, were made more widely available through TechNet and MSDN subscriptions. So that is why we're now listing 8.1 and IE11 as a latest version, because that's the latest version that's out there.
Yeah, we've been using 8.1 and IE11 internally for a while. It's great.
Right. Yeah, I've got it.
Really nice.
I've got it up right now,
mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact. But getting back to this particular update, so Jonathan, I look at it, and yes, we've got 10 CVEs here, but they're all mm-hmm. privately disclosed.
Right.
I don't see anything unusual as far as attack vectors or anything else. Is there anything really out of the ordinary with this?
Not really. You know, sometimes we'll do some defense in depth changes we want to talk about here, mm-hmm. but none of that is here. I guess it's just great news that they're all reported directly to us from security brokers in most cases. But pretty typical use after free IE cases, not much different than what we do most months here.
Okay, great. So as we go on to the next slide, we'll see the additional details that go along with this bulletin. But again, nothing out of the ordinary as far as cumulative updates for IE go. So moving on to our next update, MS-13-070 covers vulnerability in OLE, and that's object linking and embedding, which could allow remote code execution. This is a deployment priority of 2 and has an exploit index of 1. This addresses 1 privately reported CVE. And Jonathan, I look at this and it isn't directly related to Office,
right.
But it seems like very similar to Office in that you could open a file and own, what I call open and own,
right.
Which you'll see is kind of a trend for us this month. What sort of files would have that OLE object in it that you would potentially mm-hmm. open and get code execution for?
Yeah, you're right. This is really a Windows technology. It's OLE 32. It came into us as a Visio file. Visio is one of the technologies that uses OLE 32, and we reproduced it internally as Visio. There are some theoretical other attack vectors, because if it really were just the Visio attack vector, we would probably rate that as an important class vulnerability. But we were able to hit the same code path. We couldn't trigger the vulnerability, but we were able to hit the same code path through the Explorer thumbnail preview view. So the attack vector there would be an attacker lures you over web dev or SMB to a share with Explorer, not Internet Explorer, but the shell. And you preview the contents there. We weren't able to trigger the vulnerability there, so the most likely attack vector is really through a Visio file. It's a Windows component, but kind of exposed through Visio.
Okay, so kind of similar to an open and own, but like
said,
still you've got the Windows Explorer potential there, and that's why we list that as critical.
Right.
And don't include Visio, but Visio is going to be your most likely attack
vector. That's right, double-click on a Visio file and open it, yeah.
Okay, great. Moving on to our next update, MS-13-071 is a vulnerability in the Windows theme component, which could allow remote code execution. This is a deployment priority of 3 for us and has an exploit index of 1 for older versions of the OS. We have 1 privately reported CVE here. And Jonathan, we don't see Windows theme crop up too often.
No.
Yeah, we've got a few oddballs in this month.
Yeah.
But this seems, again, not Office related, but relatively straightforward, open and own, if you get a malicious theme file.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a way to a method to automatically install a theme, or is user interaction always going to be rewired?
You really have to trick a user into double-clicking a .theme file. I guess you pointed out that it really affects mostly older platforms. Windows 7 and later platforms are not affected by this particular vulnerability, so that's good news. But I guess in general, if you get an unexpected .theme file, I mean, don't click on it.
Yeah.
I guess it's kind of the general advice.
Yeah, and I really would expect this to be somebody browsing, looking for new themes. I can't imagine many people would receive a theme file via email and double-click on it.
Yeah.
At least, I'm hoping not.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's move on to our next update, which is MS-13-072, which covers vulnerabilities in Microsoft Office, which could allow remote code execution. This is a deployment priority of 2 for us and has an exploit index of 1 for older versions. We have 13 CVEs here that are all privately reported. So Jonathan, we got a bunch of memory corruption issues here. And again, most of these look like a straightforward open and own sort of situation. But what caught my eye was actually the last CVE in the bulletin, which is CVE 2013-3160, which is an information disclosure issue. Mm-hmm. And I was curious, what sort of information disclosure could happen here? What sort of information is actually being put at risk through this issue?
Yeah, we're going to actually come across this a couple more times as the webcast goes on here. This same vulnerability was present in several products. The first time I guess we're encountering it here is in Word. XML has a number of great features. One of them is you can reference an external entity inside an XML file. So if you were to open, in this particular bulletin, if you were to open an XML file in Word, it will attempt to resolve and fetch this external entity. Normally, that's used for, hey, download this thing from the website and put it in your Office document. There is a trick that a researcher discovered that can be referenced locally. So you can reference a local file, and then there's a second trick. You can send that as part of a HTTP transaction to a remote server. So the attack would look like you open an XML file in Word. It references, say, a local file. You have to know what the file name is. So let's say it's boot.ini, which is always the root of the C drive. Mm-hmm. In the Office document, there's a component that does a HTTP GET, and in that HTTP GET transaction, it sends as a query string the contents of the file. So if an attacker knows an exact file name on your system and can trick you into opening this file, the contents of that file will be included in an HTTP transaction to a server they control.
Okay.
We're going to see this in a couple more products.
Right. So this is one of the shared CVEs we talked about briefly.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Okay, great. And as far as the other remote code execution and memory corruption issues, relatively straightforward, open and own from what I see. If we go on to the next slide, I believe we've got some additional information here. Yeah, it doesn't look like anything really out of the ordinary.
Yeah, these are all reported by our friends at Google. They pointed their fuzzer at Word in this case, and they gave us a number of crashes that we triaged down to these root causes. So all fuzzing bugs again.
Okay. Well, on that theme, let's go ahead and move to our next update, which is MS-13-073. This is vulnerabilities in Microsoft Excel, which could allow remote code execution. Again, this is deployment priority of 2, and in this case, we have an exploit index of 3, as we kind of discussed earlier. All 3 CVEs addressed by this bulletin were reported privately. So, Jonathan, we talked about the XI of 3 here.
Right.
But beyond that, this looks like another straightforward, open and own issue. Anything else with the Excel bulletin here to note?
There's the 2 CVEs that are fuzzing bugs, this time from the US cert. Then there's that XML external entity resolution vulnerability again. So we first talked about it in the last bulletin. It's again here in the Excel file. So an XML file open in Excel this time could potentially reveal the contents of a local file if an attacker knew what the path and the file name were.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
So that is something good to note.
Yep.
And moving on to our next bulletin now, we have MS-13-074, which is a vulnerability in Microsoft Access, which could allow remote code execution. Again, a product we don't see pop up too often, usually once or twice a year maybe, so this is its month. This is a deployment priority of 2 for us and has an exploit index overall of 1 on the latest versions and 3 for one of those CVEs for older versions. We have a total of 3 CVEs here, all of which were privately disclosed. So access, I mean, this is one we don't deal with too often. Yeah. What does the attack scenario look like for this particular issue? Is it similar to the Excel and the Word where we've got an open and known? Or is it different because we're dealing with access in a database?
It's the same kind of deal. An attacker has to trick you into opening an access file. I mean, this particular vulnerability, the file format is ACCDB, the access database file. So an attacker would email this to you or maybe try and serve it up to you from a web page. You'll get a normal, just like the same user experience with any kind of open and own, as you were saying.
Okay.
Scenario.
Okay, and again, if you're receiving access database files in email from people you aren't expecting, probably not the best idea to open those.
Well, you know, you might even think about just dropping those at the perimeter exchange server, because if you don't ever expect to interact with access with external people, you can just drop some of those file formats. You can't do that with Word, but you totally could with access.
Yeah, that's an interesting scenario, too, and it would still involve some cleverness on the part of the tricksy axers, as it were.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's interesting. Let's move on to another one we don't see popping up too often, which is MS-13-075. This is a vulnerability in Microsoft Office IME, which is the input method editor, and specifically this one is for Pinion. This issue could allow elevation of privilege. Deployment priority of 3 has an overall exploit index of 1 for older versions. We have 1 privately reported CVE here. And since this is for Pinion, I'm guessing not a whole lot of people are really going to be affected by this issue.
Yeah.
But for those who are, what does the elevation look like? Are you going from anonymous to user? Are you going from user to root? Mm-hmm. Where is the elevation of privilege occurring in this input method editor?
Yeah, the Pinion IME is installed with the Chinese version of Office. So if you have a Chinese version of Office, you'll get this Pinion as a it's like the on-screen keyboard that comes up when you need to enter alternate character sets, in this case Chinese. And at login, you'll have an option, if you've installed this Pinion, if you normally use it, you'll have an option to use the on-screen keyboard to enter your login credentials. In that UI, pre-auth, pre-login, at the login screen, you can click around on that Pinion, and one of them is this add search scope, and it launches a browser. Now, you haven't logged in yet, so this is the browser running as system pre-auth. And once you get the browser running, you could launch commands from the browser. So this is, I guess, interactive login, not yet logged in, and elevating to system privileged.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
So for those of you who are running that Pinion, definitely this is one we definitely recommend to go ahead and get out there. Understand it's a pretty narrow focus. I know ours is not exactly the most popular IME out there.
Most people use Google's.
Yeah, most people use a different product, which shall not be named. So let's move from some unfamiliar territories to a little bit more charted, a little bit more regular territories by looking at our next update. This is MS-13-076, which is vulnerabilities in the kernel mode drivers, which could allow elevation of privilege. This is deployment priority 2 for us this month and has an overall exploit index of 1 for older versions. And we have 7 CVEs here that are all private. And one note on that exploit index as well, similar to the IE update, we're now considering Windows 8.1 RTM as the latest version of the software for XI ratings. So beyond that note, Jonathan, I look at this and it's like, well, okay, this is a relatively straightforward KMD update where you have to log in, run a specially crafted application, then you get kernel mode access. Anything unusual with this update that we should really note for folks?
You know, it's just a normal local EOP. I guess one thing that's kind of interesting to those in the security world, the researchers in this case that reported this had some really clever research that generated these vulnerabilities. They presented that research at Black Hat. They built an emulator. And it was really well done. So the research presented at Black Hat netted these vulnerabilities.
Okay, but just to clarify, these vulnerabilities themselves weren't publicly disclosed.
That's right. The research, the technique used, the their research ideas were presented there, and then they reported the bugs to us, and we fixed them.
Okay, that's great to note that folks are still practicing that coordinated vulnerability disclosure and helping us protect our customers. So let's move on to our next update, which is MS-13-077, and this is a vulnerability in the Windows SCM, which is the Service Control Manager. This could allow for elevation of privilege. Here we have a deployment priority of 3 and an exploit index of 2 for our one privately reported CVE. And Jonathan, I look at this, I'm like SCM, so I'm reading through it, and it struck me that it looks very similar to a KMD bulletin in that you run a specially crafted application to exploit this. Of course, the big difference is now you're getting things to execute with SCM privileges instead of at kernel level. What would those SCM privileges allow an attacker to do?
Yeah, the Service Control Manager is that component that starts services and stops services, and it's fetching from the registry. So as Dustin was saying, you have to be able to manipulate the system in order to trigger this vulnerability. You have to be able to write to the registry where the SCM is pulling from. And if you can do that, if you already have rights on the system to do that, you can elevate to a higher privilege, which is what SCM runs at.
Okay, so it's a higher privilege, but it's not the highest privilege.
Right.
It's still high enough that you definitely want to apply the update and make sure your systems are protected.
There may even be pathway from where SCM runs higher. You know, it's once you get in a privileged level, it's tricky to protect yourself from that level. It is not the highest level, you're right.
Right.
It is still a privileged level, though.
Okay. Moving on to our next update, we have MS-13-078, which is a vulnerability in Microsoft Front Page, which could allow information disclosure. Again, a component we don't often get to talk about here on Second Tuesdays, or Second Wednesdays in our case today. But this is a deployment priority of 3 for us and has an exploit index defaulting to 3 again because it is information disclosure. We have one privately reported CVE here. And Jonathan, again with the information disclosure, it's the question I ask, is this the same as what we previously discussed or different one? What is the information being put at risk here?
It's that same XML entity resolution issue. So in this case, you're opening the XML blob with front page. So we talked about it in Word, we talked about it in Excel. This is just the same thing now happening with front page.
Okay, and remind me, do you have to know the location of the file that you want?
You do, Dustin.
Okay, good.
You have to know the path and the file name to that file, and if you don't know that, you can't just fetch all files. There's no wild card you can do, anything like that.
So no directory listing through this.
That's right.
No reading other people's resumes. If you want to look at the contents of boot.ini or other well-known components.
Yeah, I was thinking one way an attacker maybe could use this. If they're trying to do reconnaissance on a target, I guess you could tell that a file had been opened. You could tell that your Word document that you sent to them had been opened. I can't think of a great way to know the path to an interesting file. But you can tell that your office document, your front page document, whatever, was opened.
Okay.
I don't know.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, they're tricksies. So there are a lot of different things folks could do with it.
Yeah.
And again, that's why we went ahead and took the opportunity to update it before there was any customer impact.
Yep.
Okay, moving on to our final update for this month. We have MS-13-079, which is a vulnerability in Windows Active Directory, which could allow denial of service. This is a deployment priority of 2 for us this month and has an exploit index defaulting to 3, again because it's denial of service, for the one privately reported CVE. And Jonathan, since it is DOS, you probably know the question I'm going to ask is, what are we looking at? Is it a service stop? Is it a blue screen? Is it permanent? Is it temporary? What does the DOS actually look like?
Yeah, this is an LDAP issue. So an attacker sends a flood of a certain configuration of LDAP requests, and the LDAP service actually runs out of sockets. So if you restart the service, if you restart the LDAP service, it'll release all the sockets and you're good to go. But as you know, I mean, a domain controller that can't service sockets for LDAP, that could really disrupt your domain.
That's pretty much changing it to a doorstop.
Yeah, it's not much use.
So that was really kind of my next question. Is normally when we see a denial of service issue like this, it ends up as a deployment priority of three. But this month we have it as two. Is that because the target is generally going to be that critical server in your enterprise infrastructure?
Yeah, it's only a DOS, but boy, of all the things to DOS, if you can DOS a domain controller, that'll make for a bad day.
That's that's one of Dilbert proportions right there.
Yeah.
I just coined that. I think I'll use that from now on. I did want to address just a couple of things before we continue. We have gotten a couple questions through Twitter, so thank you very much on that. We are going to get to those questions here. We're going to get those answered for you very shortly. I also wanted to note that the astute observers may have noticed that last Thursday, we said there were 14 updates on the way.
Oh, yes.
And then yesterday, we had 13 updates.
Yes.
And the short story is we detected, we really do test all of our updates really pretty much until the very last minute. And unfortunately, we did detect a quality issue with one of the updates. And rather than have that quality issue go out and impact customers adversely, we decided to just pull the update until the quality issue was resolved and re-release that later. The good news on that issue is we were not aware of any active attacks or any customer impact from the from what we were addressing there. So to me, that's key. Also, if you're looking for Bulletin re-releases this month, we don't have any. So you haven't missed them, and they're not yet to come. So we can just say thank goodness on
that's
that
good.
One, and no re-releases for this month as of today. Okay. So moving on, we do have one advisory revision to talk about, and of course that is Security Advisory 2755801. This advisory was revised yesterday, and it does cover the latest Adobe Flash updates, for Internet Explorer 10 and now 11 on Windows 8 and Windows 8.1. Details about the vulnerabilities addressed by this update are available on Adobe's site. Okay, moving on to our detection and deployment slide. While we look at this and see a jumble of yeses and nos, I did want to mention one thing very important that I'm quite happy to say. NBSA 2.3 preview version is now available for Microsoft Connect.
That's great.
And it does add support for Windows 8, Windows 8.1, Server 2012, and Server 2012 R2. A Microsoft's account is required to download the preview version, but it is available for free. So that's great. If you've got a Microsoft account, you can definitely just Bing NBSA preview, and it'll show you that and give you a link right there if I get a chance. That's another thing I should probably live tweet out.
Yeah, that'll help people. I know there's a lot of interest in that, and people were disappointed NBSA wasn't working with Windows 8 yet. That's great.
So I'm happy it's in preview. I don't know when it'll be going final, but hopefully by the time 8.1 goes generally available, this will also go generally available.
I'll check that out.
Yeah.
Cool.
As for the data that we're looking at this month for detection and deployment guidance, we have mostly yeses across the board. The exception, of course, is the updates for Office, SharePoint, and FrontPage. These are not available through Windows Update, but they are available through Microsoft Update. So moving on to the additional information about the updates themselves, we do have a small bit of good news this month in that only three of the updates are going to require a reboot. Everything else is a maybe. This is a good time to remind you that you can typically avoid reboots for these updates by ensuring that you exit out of all running programs prior to installing the update. Everything this month is uninstallable, with the one exception for Excel, which cannot be uninstalled on Office for Mac 2011 only. The updates for Outlook, OLE, Theme, IME, FrontPage, and Active Directory do not replace any previous bulletins. But the other ones will have at least one bulletin superseded, and I think in four cases, we're superseding multiple bulletins. So please look at the bulletin details to get the exact list of that, or take a look at the slide once we post it later. Again, as a reminder, if we get a question that we're not able to get to on the air, or if, again, I just ramble on a little bit too quickly, we will be posting the video as well as a full TPQA to our blog in just a couple of days. That's at microsoft.com/msrcblog. So if I miss anything or if you want to take a look at it again later, that'll be available to you to peruse at your own leisure in just a day or two. So moving on to our MSRT update this month, our MSRT partners have added one family, and that is SIMDA. This is a family of password-stealing Trojans that may also allow backdoor access and control to an affected computer. Its main purpose is to steal passwords and system information from an infected system, and it includes Trojan, backdoor, password stealing, downloader, and file infector variants. That's pretty complex, and it actually puts it into the same category as Allurion and Cyrefef. As usual, the MMPC has written a blog about this, which details the addition and goes into some further details about the SIMDA variant and what all that it does. And as a matter of fact, that's a pretty handy thing to note. So if you're interested in reading that blog, you can check out blogs.technet.com/MMPC or follow us on Twitter, because I just tweeted it. So here we go, trying to stay ahead of things and use that whole real-time social media feedback. As always, MSRT is available through WSUS 3.0, or you can download it at microsoft.com/malware-remove. Thanks for joining us. Please review the questions and answers transcript for additional information, and you can follow us on Twitter for any late-breaking news. Until next month, this is Dustin Childs for Microsoft Security Response.
Please take a moment to rate this video.